Okay, welcome to my talk about Kotlin EE, Boost Your Productivity. Kotlin EE is not a product. I just tried to invent this name because I'm working for a huge company. And huge companies often like these names like Enterprise Edition and so on. And today I want to show you how you can be very productive if you combine a very pragmatic language with a cool framework and some other stuff. Oh, should put it on, so yeah. Okay, as I told you, I'm working for a big company, so we always have disclaimers like this one here. In short, it means if you retry what I show you today and you blow up the internet or whatever, it's not our fault. That's a short version. Okay, a few words about myself. I'm working at an insurance company in Switzerland, the CSS insurance company. I'm working as an agile coach there. I'm a lecturer, part-time lecturer, one day a week. I'm teaching software development, web development at a technical college. And as you can see, like today, I'm speaking at conferences, etc. And yeah, since quite some time, I'm writing articles for magazines, and short, there will be my first book finished, hopefully. Oh yeah, and I'm leading some communities. The Hacker Garden is every month in Lucerne and a lot of other cities. I'm a member of the board of the Java User Group Switzerland, the Kotlin Swiss User Group, and I'm in the organization team of the Workspace Zurich and Basel One. Okay, and this is my book, Kotlin Web Development. It is about developing full-stack web applications with Kotlin and React, and it will be finished, I hope, around third quarter this year. The title may change, but I think the ISBN number is fixed. Okay, I like it a little bit doing a buzzword bingo, because everyone here talks about monolith, and if you tell you are working with a monolith, then look at you and, oh no, poor people, because monoliths are bad by default. And then they tell you, you should use microservices, because with microservices you can solve every problem. And when you start with microservices, you run into different problems. And once you run into it, someone comes around the corner and tells you, well, maybe you should try nanoservices. Until today, I have no idea what is the difference between microservices and nanoservices. Okay, and then a lot of people talk to you and tell you, Docker is a really cool thing. So if you want to publish your application, use Docker. And it is cool, and show you why. And when, well, at our company, we use a lot of Java EE, or Jakarta EE, since a few days. We use a lot of Jakarta EE applications. And if you tell this to somebody, they look at you and they say, oh no, it's such a huge and heavy framework. It's so bloated. And today I like to show you that this must not be the case. Often it is a case, because you can do big bloated applications, but you do not have to. Okay, why Kotlin? At first, I think Kotlin is a very pragmatic language. And if you look at Kotlin, it's statically typed. I like statically typed languages. It's object-oriented, like Java. It's compatible to Java, so you can use all Java classes, all Java frameworks, libraries, etc. And it's very easy to learn. On the other side, you can create Java 6 and Java 8 bytecode. So if you have, for example, a Java EE ecosystem, and maybe you have not the bleeding edge technology of application server running, maybe it's a few years old, you can only run Java 6 bytecode. And with Kotlin, you can use streams, lambdas, and all the stuff, and compile to Java 6 bytecode. And another cool thing is you can transpile to JavaScript. So we can have the same language on the front end and the back end. And very new is you can compile to native. so you can create native applications for macOS, Linux, Windows, etc. But very important, Kotlin comes from a company who builds tools. So with Kotlin, you have a very good tooling support. Often languages are invented before tooling support for the languages was available. With Kotlin, you have both at the same time. The syntax of Kotlin is, if you know Java, it's very easy to understand. You have functions. They start with fun because they are funny to write. And this is a main function, just fun, main, args, etc. And as you can see, the type of the parameter is behind the parameter. That's one of the biggest change. And when you create a variable, you can have two type of variables. You can write var and val. And with val you have a value. This is immutable. You can't change it afterwards. And here I create a string. And as you can see, I do not specify that event is of type string. The compiler recognizes it automatically because I have a string on the right side. Yeah. And then I do a print line, and I do not have to import print line because it's a very common command you use in your applications. To log, everybody knows that. And as you can see, you can use or you can reference your variables inside your string. You have string templates. When you define classes, you can define the properties your classes needs directly after the name of the class. And here, as you can see, I define three properties for the classes for the class. One name, age, and company. And if you look at name and company, there's a difference. And name, I specify string. And company, I specify string with a question mark. That means name and age can never be null. It's checked at compile time. And company can be null. So the question mark identifies a variable of type string that can be null. A very important change is, or a very important difference between Java and Kotlin is that in Java, all classes are open by default. That means you can extend them. And if you do not want to allow to extend a class, you define it as final. In Kotlin, it's the other way around. Every class is final by default. And if you want to allow someone to extend the class, you have to specify the open keyword. A very nice feature of Kotlin is data classes. So if you create entities, you just write data class. And for the properties you specify, there will be automatically created constructors, getters, and setters if they are not immutable. In this example, you will have getters for name and age, and company, and a setter for company. Oh no, it's everything is val. Sorry, my fault. You will only have getters. And if you specify the data keyword, you have automatically generated constructors. You have toString methods, equals, hash code, everything done for you. And a very nice feature is you can copy these objects, these entities. And the copy method has parameters, so you can specify which property should be different in the copy. When you specify a property, you can add default values to it. And if you add default values, like this, for example, and you will have two constructors, one with the required parameters, name and age, and one with name, age, and company. And if you do not specify the company will be null because null here is a default. And you can use named parameters. So if you have a lot of parameters and, for example, maybe you see it, sometimes you have null, 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 null values or some numbers, you can add the name of the parameter to it so it's easier to read. And if you add the name, the order is fully independent. So if you like, you can specify age first, name last, or vice versa. It doesn't matter. And if you have a lot of numbers or nulls, it's much easier to read and to know which value is for what property. Yeah, you can use string templates, as I showed to you earlier. And in the string templates, you can access directly the properties of the object. And you can use optionally the curly braces. You need the curly braces to specify the start and the end of the object you want to have printed in the string. In the case, the compiler can't get it on its own. So this is very easy. There is a space after markers.name, so the compiler can do it on its own. You can use multi-line strings too. So if you have some blocks, for example, you create HTML output or something like this, you can use multi-line strings. And inside of the multi-line strings, of course, you can enter references to your objects. Singletons are much easier with Kotlin than with Java. You just replace class with object, and that's it. So you do not have to take care of creating the object, of checking that you have only one instance, and so on. It's automatically done for you. And to access it, you just use the methods like static methods. Coroutines is a very old feature. I think about more than 30 years at least. And it's built into Kotlin, and it's very cool because you can do asynchronous programming. You can execute multiple tasks in parallel without using threads. So in this example, I call the price service 10 times. And that does not mean that I have 10 threads running. I specified the common pool here to the async command, so it looks into the common pool. And the coroutines is, Wolf knows Node.js. Yeah, oh, a lot of people. So in Node.js, you have only one thread. And with coroutines, several coroutines can share the same thread. So you can just execute 100,000 coroutines on your machine. And if you execute 100,000 threads, your machine will die. Possibly. Very nice feature is you can use a lot of type-safe builders which are available, and you can create your own type-safe builders very easy. So you can create, for example, HTML output, and with the DSL you specify here, you have full compile time checks, so you can't misspell something, and you can, of course, refactor everything. Okay, why Java EE? I call Java EE library management as a service. Because in the past, I often ran into something like a class path hell. You add a dependency. These dependencies has more dependencies. And often it happened to me that I have, for example, Guava in my class path in three different versions. And what works now? What is a version in production, what is a version on my machine, and so on, and that's a hell. So you have to take care of which versions of the dependencies, direct dependencies, and transitive dependencies you have in your class path. And that can be very complicated. And with Java EE, you have only one dependency, the Java EE dependency. And the providers of the Java EE framework, like Red Hat or Oracle or IBM, they have to take care of that all the dependencies they have in their class paths are working together. And as you can see, there are a lot of dependencies like JAX-RS, WebSockets, JPA, bean validation, etc., which is very cool if you want to write services and microservices, and you often add them on your own. And it's very easy to use Docker with it. There are a lot of Docker containers you can use right ahead. So like Payara is a Glassfish. and Whitefly, JBoss, etc. All these providers for application servers provide a Docker image containing their application server. So you just add your application to it, and everything is done. So you have a layer here, your application always on the top. That is very important because you build your application very often. It changes on every build. And you do not want to put everything together, like an application server, a Java virtual machine, and so on, in every build, because, well, a Java virtual machine does not change very often. So create different layers, or use a layer provided by the application server provider, and just put your application on top. And if you have additional dependencies or configurations, create a separate layer for it. So this makes your build very fast, because you only build your application, and if you create your Docker image, it's only one layer on top. Yeah, and very important, Java EE is a standard, so you're not bound to one company. So if you have a problem, maybe, let's say, well, WebSphere needs sometimes a little longer to provide a new version with compatibility for new Java versions. So maybe you can just switch to a different provider. So it's very easy to switch between them. But only if you develop against the Java EE API. If you start using classes which are provided by the application servers, then you are lost and then you are bound to this company. Okay, Kotlin EE. There are some things you have to mention when you use Kotlin with Java EE or with Jakarta EE. At first, I told you classes are final by default. And application servers like to create proxies. And they can not create proxies from a standard Kotlin class because it's closed. It can't be extended. And if you do it, if you make it open and check it in with the open keyword, then not only the application server can extend it, he's fine, but also your colleagues can extend it. They say, oh, it's ready to extend. I will do it. And that's not so nice. So a very nice thing is to use this dependency here. It comes from JetBrains itself. It's called Kotlin All Open. And with this extension in your build, you specify some annotations. And when the compiler finds these annotations, this class will be made open. And that's at compile time, at build time. So your IDE just sees the source code and takes care that nobody extends your class, but the application server is able to extend your class. So problem one solved. Problem two is you often need zero argument constructors. And for this, you have another extension for your build system. It's called Kotlin NoArg. And here you can specify other annotations for classes where you need a zero argument constructor. Well, these are two very handy things. Okay, I don't like talking so much in theory. I like showing you how it works and how I work with it. So I do a live coding here. And if I do mistakes, you can just enjoy or you can shout down to me when you see the stupid error. I will do stupid errors. And what I create is the two services which communicate to each other. One service, a hello service, very stupid, says only hello, is reachable from the outside. It's running in a cloud with, for example, three instances. And the time service is running in the cloud too, but not reachable from the outside. And the hello service uses the time service. Time service is very stupid too, it just returns the time. It's just a showcase. Okay. So, here I created two projects. The time service. This is a build file. The important part of the build file is, of course, you have to apply the plugin, the Kotlin plugin. Then I apply the all open and the no arc plugins, and a var plugin to create a var file which will be deployed to the application server. I configure the all open plugin and the no arc plugin, as you could see in the slides before, just to look for these annotations. And I told the var plugin that I want to use just this var, file name here for the var file. I have two dependencies here. One dependency is the Java EE dependency. Important here is that it is a provided dependency. So you do not ship the Java EE library with your application. It comes with the application server. And what you have to ship with your application is a Kotlin standard library. In this example, I use a Kotlin standard library JIE 8. From JIE 6, just change 8 to 6. And here I configure the Kotlin compiler to use Java bytecode version 1.x for the code and for the tests. Well, I do not have tests, but I just wrote it. So that is the complete build file for a service using Kotlin and Java EE. Most of the time, this is absolutely enough, and most of the time you do not need more. Okay, let's start. Oh, I forgot to delete everything here. Do it now. I think it is here too. Yeah. So I delete all the code here. And now I need my notes because speaking and typing can be difficult. So if you write a service which uses Java EE and you want to create a RESTful JSON API, you usually do it with JAX-RS. And JAX-RS has to be configured. So I create a Kotlin class. I call this JAX-RS configuration. The name doesn't matter. And if I create a class, it looks like a Java class. And a JAX-RS application has to extend the application class from JAX-RS. And to extend a class, you do not write extend, you add a colon in the end. No? Not editable? Editable? Yeah, funny. I just reopened it. Whew. So, it's live. I can't type anymore. That's fun. Thanks. It's not the EAP, so okay. To extend a class, you use a colon in Kotlin. And here I extend the application class from JAX-RS and the import. And if you extend something, you have to specify which constructor should be used from the class you extend from. And here I use the no argument constructor. So this is how to extend a class in Kotlin. And now I want to add a path to the URI, and I use the application path. And I want to prefix the access of my service with just API. So API is the first part of the path if I want to access my service. So every services I add have this prefix now. Okay, that's everything with the configuration. Now I write the service. The service is just a standard Kotlin class. I call it time resource. Good. And this service should be reachable by the time URI. So I write path time. Now the service has a complete URI API slash time. And I want to produce text output here. Produces media type text plane. Okay. Now let's write the service. The service should answer a GET request, so I write at GET, just like in Java. And I specify the function. I call it get time with no parameters, and it returns a string. And now I just return local date time. Local date time is not a Kotlin class, it's a Java 8 class. So I can just use it. Dot now. And I make a string of it. I do not write a colon here. I can write a semicolon at the end, but I do not need to. And this is everything you need to specify a very stupid service. That's all. Now let's create the Docker image. To create the Docker image, I like to use Pyara. Pyara is a GlassFish with some add-ons. And yeah, this Docker file has only two lines. So the parent image is Pyara micro, and I just have to copy the var file to the deployment directory. That's everything. So now I go to, you will find everything on GitHub. I should make it bigger, I think. So. So it, I just run the Gradle build. This will create the var file. Yeah. No. Shut up. Good. And now I want to create the Docker image. But before, let's look how big it is. Build libs. There we have 818 kilobytes. That's because we have here the Kotlin standard library included in the var file. So Docker build tech. Do not wonder, this is just my GitHub username. Oops, I forgot to specify the dot. That means search for the Docker file in the current directory. Okay, there's a new version now. I did not specify the version number of Pyara in my Docker file, so now it downloads a new one. Okay. We do not wait for it. We continue with writing the second service. The interesting part of the second service is that it has to call the first one. So at first we have to configure the JAX-RS here because it's a completely independent service. Application path. The prefix is API, and we have to extend the application class from JAX-RS. So JAX-RS configured. Oh, forgot to specify the constructor. Okay. And now let's add the hello service. It's just a standard Java class, a Kotlin class. And I specify a path, let's say hello. hand, again, we produce text plane. So, just to keep the example simple. Again, we have a get method here, and we want to answer to this get method with the hello call. Function, say hello. And here I want to get the name of the person who calls me, so I can say hello Mark or hello Jeff. So I want to get it from the URL, and I just specify name. This should be a string. And to get it out of the URL, I use pathparam. And here I specify a placeholder. Let's use name, for example, without the curly braces. And yeah, that's it. Now we can answer. We can just return. And we can use string templates here. Hello. Name and new line and the time, but we need to get the time from the time service, so we have to call the time service. And to use the time service, we have to specify it before. We just create a mutable web target. Let's call it time service. And for web targets, I can use a client builder and just ask the client builder to create a new client, which does all the HTTP stuff for me. And he should send the request to HTTP. And now is a question, when it runs in the cloud, how do I know where runs my service? Docker can, when you create a service with Docker, it creates a DNS entry with the same name as a service. So we can just write HTTP time service. And there it's port 8080, there runs application server, / API / time. Yeah, that's it. And to use the service, I call it using the time service dot request that actually sends the request. And I want the result of it. I get the result, and the result should be transferred to a string because I just want to use it here as a string. And now it's a little bit strange. We write here string class dot Java. Kotlin has a string class and Java has a string class. So we have two string classes. The Kotlin string class is much more powerful, but at this time I just want to use the Java string class. Okay. Oh, no colon at the end, not needed. And I would like to get the host name, because if I want to test my scaling, it's nice to have the host name in the output so I can see the request goes to different hosts. Just get localhost dot hostname. And here you see I do not write get hostname. It's a Java class, but I access it like a property, because getter and setter in the Kotlin world is a property. And if there is no functionality in the getter, then it converts automatically converted to a property. So I can use the point notation. Okay, and I want to add it here, $time and $hostname. Okay, now he has some problems. Return string. Ah, I did not specify the return value here, the return type. It's a string. So this is a way how to make a call to a different service, just JAX-RS. And sometimes you have to take care to use the correct classes. Okay, the time service was successfully built. Now let's create the same with the hello service. Assemble the war file. And run the Docker build. This is exactly the same. As you can see now, it's very fast because the download was already done before. If you look at the Docker file, just the name of the war file is the difference. That's the only difference here. Okay. Now let's start and deploy it. So I already prepared my machine because it takes some time to set up a complete node. With Docker, it's really cool if you use Docker Swarm for a cloud. There you can use Docker Machine to create a node, as you can see here, there in that line. Here I created a node using the VirtualBox driver. So Docker Machine create driver VirtualBox. So it connects to my locally running VirtualBox and creates a node on my machine. There are several other drivers, so you can connect to Google Cloud Engine, Amazon, and other. Maybe you have to specify your credentials then, but then it sets up a complete node for you. It installs the operating system, networking support, SSH keys, Docker, etc., everything for you. And the last parameter here, MGR, is just the name of the machine. So I created one machine with the name MGR. I will use it later as a manager. And I created three nodes, node 1, 2, and 3. Everything with the same command, just the name is different. Then you can log in to your machines using Docker Machine SSH MGR. It will automatically look where your machine is running, where your node is running, and connect to it. And to create a cloud, to create a Docker Swarm, you have to initialize it. And when you initialize it, you have to specify the public IP address of the manager. The manager is a single point of entry. And I did this already because installing the operating system, etc., might take some time. Then there is a nice tool created named Visualizer. It visualizes your nodes. It's very, very simple. You can't do nothing else. I started it already. This is what it looks like. So we have four nodes, or four machines, one manager and three worker. Just with the commands you see here on the slide. And to connect everything together, you log in to a node, independently of where it is running, on Google, Amazon, or wherever, and just execute Docker Swarm join. And at the token you can get from your manager, and it will connect the machines together in a cloud. You can connect local machines, machines from your own data center, Google Cloud Engine, Amazon, and wherever into one cloud. Okay, so that's just to verify some commands. Okay, now I would like to create a network for the tests. So I log in to the manager, Docker Machine SSH Manager. Now I'm logged in on the manager. And every command I execute now has to be executed on the manager. You do not interact with the nodes directly. Docker does it for you. So I create a network. I use the overlay driver. That means you have a network with this name on all machines in your swarm, independently of where it is running. I call this network voxed. And of course, the networks can be listed. And there you see the voxed network. Okay. Now let's create the service and deploy our application. This is done with Docker service create. I want to run the service in the Vox network. I give it a name, time service. This is used for the internal DNS. And of course, the tag name of the Docker image. And I execute this all on the manager node. I do not interact with the worker nodes. And my second service should be reachable from the outside, so I specify a port forwarding. Started to. And I can list the services with Docker service list or ls. I'll make it a little bit smaller. Yeah. And here you see the ID of the service, the name that is replicated. One container is running. Yeah. And the name of the container or the name of the image. And if I take a look now at the visualizer, I see here are two services. They are were started on different nodes. And yeah, and the green bullet here, that means that these services are ready. Okay, now let's go and access the service. HTTP is a nice command line utility for executing REST requests. I use the public IP address of the manager, the node name, the port, and here the path, API hello, and this is a parameter. Sorry, my fault, I'm on the manager. I execute, of course, all the requests, the HTTP requests now from my own machine. Okay, here we have the output. Hello, VoxDays Vienna, the date, time, and the host name. The host name is automatically generated. Okay, and as we can see, if we repeat the request, the host name never changes. Well, we have only one instance running. And now we can scale up and down just with this simple command, docker service update replicas 3, and specify the service name. Oh, my machine. Every command should be executed on the manager. Okay, and the same with the time service. And if I take a look now at the visualizer, I see that Docker was searching for nodes who have capacity and is starting the images there. So we have 3 hello services running and 3 time services running. And when I start, or I continue now, I'm executing the HTTP request. Just take a look at the host name. It starts with C3. The next request goes to a different host name, A4A, A9, and now again C3. So we have a very simple round robin here without specifying anything. Okay. And often you want to work with some nodes, update system, etc., so you can take make them, or you can drain them. That means that the containers who are running on this node will be moved to a different node. Because if I execute now the drain command on the manager, it will remove these 2 instances which are running, then it recognizes, oh, shit, I should have running 3 instances, but there are only 2. So it will start up with 2 new instances, so it so we have 3 instances running now, because we specified 3 instances. Okay. That's about Docker. So, in my opinion, combining a very pragmatic language with a nice framework and tools like Docker, you have a very easy to understand code. You have very fast build times because you only build a little bit of your business code, and do not create fat jars. You have reproducible deployments using Docker, and you can easily scale your services. If you use it in production or not, well, it's often it's enough to test it locally, so you can take care locally on your machine that all the scaling works with your services. And I think you can be very fast and efficient, because when you write your code, you can focus on your business code, and you do not have to think about all the underlying stuff, all the technologies there. Okay, just a commercial at the end. Maybe you ever dreamed of living in Switzerland? I know Austria is nice too, but well, we have francs. Then you are invited to join us. We are searching for people every time. We have a very big IT department, actually about 300 people, 130 software developers full time. So we are searching for crazy people. And if you like, just contact me. Okay, so that's it for now. Oh, I have some time for questions. And thank you for being here. And just to mention, using this link, you find a link to the GitHub repository with the source code and to the presentation as a PDF. And later on, if a nice video with my nice fluent English will be online, I will add a link too. Okay, thank you. Questions? No, you do not have to rebuild the whole swarm. You just restart your service. You can. I started the service without specifying a version number, so it uses automatically the latest build of the Docker image. Yes, and you can automate it. For example, that every time your project is built, a new Docker image is created, which is pushed to a registry, and the service is restarted. Or you can create, for example, a new network with a different name, with a build number in it, and then you can run multiple versions of your service at the same time in different networks. Yes, Kotlin compares in performance with Java. It compiles to bytecode. So at the time of the execution, for the VM, there is no difference which language was used to create the bytecode. It depends on the compiler. And the compiler is actually very good, so I do not notice differences. But maybe it would be a good idea, if you have mission-critical systems, to monitor it. Thank you very much for your feedback. I will add more stuff. And maybe get more time. Yeah? No, not really. Just to show a case that you can, that there are classes you have in Kotlin and in Java, like the string class. And sometimes you want explicitly one class, and you have to write it down somehow that you now want the Java version of the class. Yes, would have worked too. Oh no, sorry, I'm not sure. Because this is a parameter to a Java class. I called a Java class here. This is a get method from a Java class, from JAX.js. So I'm not sure if it will accept a Kotlin string class. That has to be tested. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much, and enjoy your food.